Welcome to this fortnight's this Hebdo's Practice Matters talk here at the Lovett Gallery. I'm John Roberts. I'm from University of Newcastle School of Architecture and Built Environment. It's fantastic to see practitioners and students and ex-students here, and first-year students here, and people from the landscape architecture profession here as well. So, and people I know and people I don't know. This evening we've got a landscape architect speaking with us, Anton James from JMD Design. But first, I'd just like to acknowledge country, because as we talk about it's at the university, we're in a country that was owned by people for a very long time. Newcastle City Council acknowledges that we are meeting on the traditional country of Wabakal and Warramai peoples. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and continuing relationship with the land, and that they're the proud survivors of more than 200 years of dispossession. Council reiterates its commitment to address disadvantages and attain justice for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples of this community. Also, Anton James is speaking with us tonight, and also we've got a gold sponsor, CSR Hebel, and we're very glad to have CSR Hebel, and Jeff Shavarthan is here. I'm sure Jeff's at the back, and he's around, and I think quite a number of us in the room use CSR Hebel building things. They call them building products. I like us to think about building materials as well, and that's another conversation. So I'm not quite sure what Anton's going to talk about tonight, but I better tell you something about him, and I'll just stick to the script because that's the best way. JMD Design's an award-winning practice that provides a full range of landscape architectural services with an emphasis on the construction of high-quality design. I don't know if JMD use Hebel products. When I was a child, CSR Hebel didn't exist. When I was a child, it was about 1937, so it wasn't. But CSR was the firm that made sugar, and CSR sugar was what caused me to lose most of my teeth. It was a bit too much information for most of them. I'll go on, but look, I'm just here to embarrass us all, Jeff, so it's fine. I'm not Ramsey Awad, but gee, I wish I was. CSR made sugar out of sugar cane from the north coast and also from up in Queensland. And early memories are of going up the north coast, and I think they're still there, the sugar mills, and they used to burn the sugar, and we used to stay in motels at Ballina and Coffs and places like that and further up. And you'd always be able to go into the cane fields, and there was always fantastic stories in social studies at school about cane. And CSR did this amazing thing where they were some of the very first users of their waste products to make building materials. And they do, despite what they contributed to the dental industry in the world, they do have a proud history of reusing their waste products in two ways, I think. One was to burn the waste products to actually fire the mills, I think that's correct. And the other was to produce kainite. And kainite's the loose, cheapo pinboard that we have around the place. And the only person I've seen, architect I've seen, who's used pinboard, who's used kainite as a material is Richard Laplastria on one of the great houses. It was the great house, the Peter Carey house, which George Negus now owns on the Never Never River up the back of Bellingen. And he used kainite, which is a very underestimated material. It's very light and will last for 20 years, which is more than most things last. I hope Hebel blocks out last kainite. It's used, and Richard used it for a very light swing-up wall. This beautiful wall in this house. So that's my plug for CSR. So thank you, CSR, for being our gold sponsor and for looking after us. Meanwhile, back at the ranch, the three working directors of JMD Design have over 20 years' experience in the profession and lead a dedicated and creative team. Anton is also a professor at RMIT, in the same vein that Peter Stutch and Richard Laplastria and Kerry and Lindsay Clare and Leon and and
Lawrence
Neal, who I didn't go and see talk today, so I've forgotten about him. Sorry, Lawrence. And because I was doing work, and Lawrence are our professors. Anton's similarly a professor at RMIT, and it's a brilliant tradition of bringing professional people into the school who actually contribute very powerful, very profound, and very, very much first-person work to the research and also the teaching and learning of the school. It's a brilliant thing, and we're very pleased that at our school we're also continuing that tradition. So Anton's also, believe it or not, a highly regarded landscape architect and artist. This is Anton's art, with more than 20 years' experience in the profession. He developed his unique design language working in Europe and North America, and that's been further strengthened by his studies in visual arts and his ongoing public art commissions. As the director of JMD Design, he brings an innovative site-specific approach to each project, producing unique outcomes that blur the boundary between art, architecture, and landscape. So, Anton, I hand the stick over to you. The evening is yours. Thank you.
I was going to start with an introduction about what I've done and who I am, but John has covered some of that. I was asked to... I was asked to talk a little about this, and I'm sorry you won't be able to read that, but this is a brief outline. I completed a PhD at RMIT 2.5 years ago, and this is one of the pages. And one of the things that PhD asked was to, in a way, look at your background and try and understand what in your background has formed the way you think about space, so your sort of spatial memory. But this timeline just very quickly sums up some of those key moments for me. I was born in Australia, I grew up in Belgium, I came back to Sydney, I studied landscape architecture in Sydney. After studying landscape architecture, I went and worked in Europe, and one of the formative experiences I had was working with Will Alsop for a couple of years in London. And that's had a lasting influence on the way I think about things. I worked with Catherine Gustafson, the American landscape architect in Paris, and I came back to Australia and decided I had enough and I went to art school. But that didn't last too long. I was sort of drawn back to landscape architecture and what I knew. You know, those early years are fairly formative. And so I set up my own practice, Anton James Design, and over a period of 10 years built several projects, some fairly important ones, but I also started to collaborate with Ingrid Mather, who I'd known from my very first job. And I sort of ran out of steam of running a practice. I decided I didn't want to do that anymore. I'd been doing it for 10 years, managing too many people, and I needed a change. And Ingrid and I started to hatch a plan that maybe we should form a new practice. And she had a business partner, James Delaney. So it gets very confusing because there's Anton James, James Delaney, James Grant in James Street, Redfern. And the three of us formed a practice. And the interesting thing about our practice, unlike I think a lot of other architectural practices, which tend to have the various directors operating as practices within practices, we have very complementary skills. And in a way, it's a bit more like a film or an ad agency. I tend to be the guy who's looking after design. Ingrid is very good on project management and contracts and financial management, lots of experience in civil engineering, and James Delaney is the guy who's on the ground making sure things get built and the documentation in. So we tend to run a practice that's a bit different to a lot of small architectural practices where whoever answers the phone takes the job and runs the whole project. As I said, I started my PhD in 2010, completed it in 2013, and then was appointed at RMIT. So what I was going to do tonight was just talk to you a little bit about what that PhD did in terms of what it revealed about the way I work, and then show you some projects. Our office is in Redfern, there's 25 people. We have a full-time construction manager and some admin staff, a variety of nationalities, and 5 senior landscape architects and urban designer. And we work in open plan sort of office. I was asked in the email that came about tonight to talk about what inspires me and what informs my work. And in a way, that's sort of the question of the PhD as well, was to try and understand what drives the way you work and why you work, and to recognize the things that are inherent in your own work to strengthen those. What inspires me is a whole range of stuff, and I tend to be fairly eclectic. And I've put some images up here with the arrows suggesting that that changes all the time and it sort of is an evolving and recurring thing. But for me, one of the great pleasures is to find things like this fantastic bridge on Kangaroo Island. It's built by the farmers, you know, it wouldn't comply with anything. It's just made out of water pipe and a couple of planks. This fantastic hedge and Nowra here that looks like it's about to get up and run away. It's at a golf course. Old concrete, industrial concrete, the way that was made, and in a very rudimentary way. So they, in a way, I call it dumb, not in a pejorative sense, but just fairly simple and matter of fact. The materiality I find fascinating. And then I love this sort of thing. This is, you know, our faithful council workers or RMS doing the markings on the road, and they've managed to make this fantastic squiggle up the road. If you tried to design that, they'd tell you you're mad and go away and make a straight line. So those sorts of quirks and accidents is something that I get a lot of pleasure out of on sites. And also this sort of material collision between sandstone and concrete and brick. The other thing that is important is working things out with experts on site and the construction, working with structural engineers. There's a bunch of collaborators I work with, architects, engineers, with whom I have a great rapport, and working things out as they evolve, I find really fascinating. The idea of something being finished is actually quite boring. If I were to go and redesign any project, I'd probably do it totally differently. And then comes the other influence, which is artwork. And I've always been interested in art. I've got a big collection of books. The artists that I'm interested in, they come and go out of fashion. Some of these are people who I've been looking at recently. There's Rachel Whitehead, this fantastic materiality and form, the strength of the form and the idea of reversing space. The British painter Fiona Ray, who uses this layered way of working with reference to all sorts of different iconography. And then, of course, Will Alsop with his sort of mad experimental work. What this led me to in the PhD was a diagram like this of what I've called Imagine Mentors. A lot of these people who I admire, I've never met, I've never talked to, I've read a book, but I kind of, you tend to project your own work into what they might think, or you project your own ideas onto their work. And this diagram tries to explain that these people sort of come in and out of focus as I'm working through a project, and you know, you forget some and they come back, and there's this endless churning of ideas rather than trying to be being stuck on a single one. In terms of what informs our work, really the PhD again has revealed to me the importance of my drawing. I have a stack of about 70 sketchbooks that were in the background until I did the PhD, and Leon van Schaik and Sam Weir sort of kept pointing me back to the sketchbooks for where it really happens and how important they are to my work. That stack, I don't know if you can read that, but that's 1989, that's 2001, it's 2011, 13, and in the years of my PhD, another 10. So the PhD really brought me back to understanding the importance of the way I work and focused on that, and drawing now has become totally central to what I do. And previously it was in the background, I wouldn't really show anybody, but it's now really a tool for communicating with the clients, and the sketchbooks have become more and more forceful, if you like, in the way that I work. The other thing that happened was to just understand some of the drivers, and I realized that in designing projects, there's three things really. That mood is very important to the way I see a site, and trying to work through the mood of a site or the character and have a dialogue with the site. And to work with a site, there's three things that I realize I do. One is I voice the project, and that is trying to find the right voice, if you like, the visual voice, the material voice, to interact with the existing site. The other one is scaling. I mean, as Richard Serra said, size is fixed, but scale is relative. And scaling is this idea of putting yourself into a relationship with what's on site. So you create the scale of a project by what you put into it. You make the site in a way through the scaling. And the last one was making the site. And that really refers to understanding whether you're working with hydrology, whether you're working with ecology, whether you're working with culture. And they're not mutually exclusive, but with what it is in a site, it's not a physical boundary necessarily, it's a whole lot of other boundaries that accumulate around that site: history, heritage, culture, ecology, system flows. So identifying those three and actually designating a voice, a scale, and a site are crucial to the way that I form the project. And the way I do that is through this looping diagram that I came up with. And the idea here is that through my work, I tend to not set out on a single idea with a clear idea at the start and just churn ahead and keep refining it. I tend to jump all over the place and go back and forth between different voices, different scales, and then also build into that, you know, precedents and budgets and client expectations. So again, there's this sort of looping around ideas until it refines itself. And that was very evident in looking at my sketchbooks. In terms of where we work, we tend to be mainly Sydney focused. A lot of our work has been, well, Ingrid and James, traditionally they had a practice that worked very much in Western Sydney on new residential subdivision work, whereas I tended to work more with architects and with public artwork in the city, and the practice now incorporates the two. But we haven't ventured much outside Sydney. There's five projects I was going to talk to you about. I've got a lot of slides, so I'll just race through them. But in a way, it's a bit reflective of the sketchbook and the kind of churn of ideas. The first of those is Paddington Reservoir Gardens that we worked on nearly 6 or 7 years ago with Tim Greer from Tompkins Like a Greer. And this was a photograph of the initial site visit. It was a fantastic site. It's on Oxford Street in Paddington. It was a 19th century water reservoir that was only in use for about 30 years before the water source became contaminated and they closed it down. And then over the next 100 years or so, it had various insertions into it. There was an auto repair shop and a service station put next to it and into it, and started to compromise the structure, and these beams started to rust and the whole structure started to fall apart, and it collapsed and was closed and then lay as a collapsed ruin for 30 years on Oxford Street. The brief we had was to put a lid on it and put some grass and shrubs on the top and maybe have the underside as being something that could be used for events. We basically went back to the council and said, we think that's a bad idea. This is a once in a lifetime opportunity to have this ruin, and it should be a sunken garden within the reservoir. One chamber was fairly intact and the other one had mostly collapsed. Just quickly, this plan with Oxford Street running along here, and it's in a part of Paddington that has the Old Town Hall and post office and Juniper Hall, so it's quite, and an old pub. So it's very historic sort of part of Oxford Street. There's a small park on the corner, the Walter Reed Reserve that was restored, but then the two chambers. The Western Chamber had mainly collapsed and the Eastern Chamber was still intact. The Western Chamber was made of British bricks. The vaults were made out of bricks imported from the UK, and the cast iron capitals on the columns and the bases were also from the UK with Australian hardwood timber posts, whereas the Eastern Chamber was made from all Australian material. I had the good fortune of being in Surrey Hills one day. There's a few of these in Sydney, and walking down the street in the middle of Surrey Hills in Crown Street, and there's a roller shutter door on the side of the footpath about this high, with a lawn running back from there, a fence around it. I've never really registered what it was. And this guy stepped out on the footpath, dripping wet, in full-bodied aqua suit, diving suit, with a hose coming out of his head, going to a generator. And the weirdest, you know, surreal moment that I realised when you looked into that roller shutter, there was one of these reservoirs. It was just into the darkness, the vaults and the water, and this compressed space between the top of the vaults and the water, amazing space. And visiting this, you got that sense that because it's not vertical, it was never designed to be inhabited. It had a strange and eerie feel to it. There was no windows, inclined walls, no corners, everything's round. And there was something about that, the idea that space would be compressed at the top, the only habitable or the only occupiable space would be this zone compressed according to the water level inside the reservoir. So I was very keen to try and somehow pick up on that, the fact that you couldn't really occupy it, and and that it was slightly uncanny space. So, what have I done? So there's a series of sketches here. I'm trying to just understand how that space should be configured and whether it should be an organic space or a formal space. And then starting to think about, well, should some of the geometry of the reservoir and the ornate Victorian detailing start to inform what that should be? Is there a way of reflecting what happens below onto the surface? And we arrived at this solution where there is this sense that, like a stain coming up through the floor, some of the geometry from below would be revealed on the surface. That the strong geometry of the vaults run east-west with the cast iron beams and column grid, that should be reflected on the top. And then that I was very keen that once inside, it was also planted in a palette of Victorian plants, very rich and exotic. Victorian plantings were very much about big leaves and textures and some slightly strange plant material. And so when you were lost in this reservoir, you could see the old pub and Juniper Hall, but you weren't aware of the street or any of the modernity that's happening up there. And that also, crucially, that circulation be kept to the outside where you're up against these sloping walls and the centre couldn't be occupied. You couldn't, again, the way it used to be, you couldn't really go and occupy the centre. The built result has a pond right in the middle there that, again, is that thing about it reflects the sky. And the thing about water in the landscape is interesting because it's sort of attractive, but it also repels you. You can't ever occupy that space of the water. It's like a mirror. You can't really go in there. And so to place that water under this remnant bit of roof and at the centre was pushing everything back out again. The eastern part is then planted with a rich mix of Victorian type planting, tree ferns, and Tompkins like a Greer came up with some very beautiful detailing for the roof. The roof had to be, essentially all the bricks had to be supported, all the old vaults had to be supported, pinned from the top, and then a new slab poured above so that the old vaults were suspended underneath this new concrete roof. And the other thing we did was, as I mentioned, we reflected this idea of a stain, that the pattern from below was staining the surface. So the pathway that winds its way through the eastern chamber has the radius of the vaults below in brick, and those bricks were recovered from the collapsing chamber, and then cast iron beams that mirror the shape of the beams below. They're quite interesting because they're tapered in two dimensions. They're tapered in plan and they're also tapered in section. And then Tim came up with a detail for this awning that repeats again, follows the vaults, and it's as though the bricks have been removed, but the mortar is what's left. The actual awning is the mortar that holds up the bricks in the vaults below. View towards the town hall. And on the street, then there's a couple of elements of, this was where we were standing below this in an original photograph, so the remnant piece of roof, and this was a wall that was the old church that stood on the corner. There was the service station, as I mentioned, on Oxford Street. So we tried to keep an idea of all those different eras, and apparently there's a Banksy bit of graffiti, bit of wall art down in the eastern chamber. So all the graffiti that was done in that eastern chamber has been retained as well. This is the westernmost chamber. So this was the pond is in here, and westernmost part of that western chamber is a simple lawn with a couple of eucalypts. And then the careful attention to detail, because it's heritage structure, everything had to be placed on top of the existing structure with so that it could be removed with no damage to the fabric. Where the roof had collapsed, and we obviously, again, this was the issue, we couldn't cut into the bottom of the reservoir and plant, so the option was the garden on the right is essentially the garden on the right is essentially a planter within the basin, but where the roof had partially collapsed, we introduced these large concrete planters with a sort of watermark on them, and in that is then some native, some planting that would have been endemic to Paddington. Now jumping totally to a different sort of project, and this one, whereas the previous one I mentioned there was that uncanny idea of not being able to occupy it and wanting to work with it, this one was sort of non-occupiable, but I wanted to reverse that. This is a park at Sydney Olympic Parklands. It's a Blaxland Common on the Parramatta River. This was master planned by the American landscape architect George Hargraves, and they carried out the first stage of the work, which is this grid of mounds. These are mounds that are probably 2 metres high with a fig tree sitting right on top of them, and then a series of terraces running down to the river and a big car park. The weird thing about that, it's got fantastic sky. There's an amazing amount of sky out there, but it's a big flat expanse of grass with another big mound by the other landscape architect from America, Peter Walker, up this end. But on these mounds, especially because there's a tree on it, you can actually never occupy the top. And on the mound, you're always facing outwards. There's no interiority on this site at all. You're always facing out. You're sitting next to someone, but everybody's facing out. And there was the sense that there was a need to be able to occupy the site somehow and have some interiority to the site. So there was a struggle of how to introduce this regional scale playground onto this site. It's also a landfill site, which means it only had 400 millimetres of soil, with a clay cap, and below that all sorts of stuff that's rotting that nobody really knew, which had some subsidence issues as well. So you couldn't dig into it. The plant material doesn't perform particularly well, and it was a big exposed site. How to put something on it? And the initial ideas were that it possibly should be a structure. The playground should be really based around a structure somehow, but that still didn't really give that sense of interiority and landscape that I was interested in. It occurred to me that this digging into the ground might be the way to approach it, and that both Hargraves and Walker had worked a lot with landform, and that somehow landform might hold the key to be in that language that they had already used right across the Sydney Olympic Parklands. So there's these attempts to try and figure out how to work with that landform and put new bits on, but it wasn't until this drawing that the idea came to me that maybe to dig in, because it's only 400 millimetres deep, you can't dig in, so you have to build up. But then to build up and extend the terrace would be scaling the project to the right scale, and would be also working with the language that was there. So to extend Hargraves' terrace and then to take his mounds but invert them as negative spaces within this extended terrace, so that we have a 350 metre long extension of these terrace mounds that then has the logic of Hargraves inverted to create spaces within which to have the playground. At the eastern end is the most active end, with the giant slides, climbing walls, a very big swing that wraps around one of Hargraves' mound and sort of terminates that eastern end. The interesting thing, again, that I mentioned before, working closely with Brian Wood, I'm the structural engineer, and because of the subsidence, this steel beam that's a 400 millimetre diameter tube, it's about 35 metres long, on legs to support all the swings and play equipment, risks breaking its back because of subsidence, the potential that somewhere a cow rots and all of a sudden one leg dips. So what we did, we had lots of legs, and we put a spring on the top of each leg and an adjustable foot on the bottom. And when it came to certification, the playground certifier came and said, oh, there's an entrapment here. Somebody's going to climb up there, they'll get their torso stuck, and they'll be stuck up the top of the pole. So we then found these navigational spheres, buoys from boats to fill the hole and make sure that you didn't have that compliance. And that's one of the other interesting things with playgrounds, is working with all these rules, trying to find a way around the rules or turn the rules into something much more interesting, because playgrounds are incredibly controlled. The certifier has this weird box, it's like a Masonic suitcase. He comes to site and he has various bits of timber on the end of a string and he walks around swinging this thing to see where it gets trapped, and he has a funny shaped sort of bit of timber like that that he prods around. So even drawings, you know, it's not until you've built it that you're really in trouble, because he comes with his bag of tricks. And we had a series of tunnels that connect right through the mound. And the idea about this was, you know, playgrounds are so, because of all these rules, they're so conservative. But the other thing we worked out was that the rules allow you to have a 45 degree slope. It's not a fall if it's not steeper than 45 degrees. And if you stand 3 meters up in the air at 45 degrees, that feels like a hell of a long way, and it's incredibly steep. So we're able to introduce this real sense of danger and adventure in this landscape, where you can go over or through or slide through tunnels, climb across a net that's over the top of the hole and then go back in through a tunnel. So the idea was to really try and make a highly dynamic and rich zone of play for the kids, and kids of all ages really. We built a large tree house that you can clamber up and get views down the river. We're very engaged with also picking up on the wind and the long views on the site. So that pokes its head up over, that's 12 metres high, and it has a rope floor in one of these boxes, so you know, you can stand 9 metres up on a bit of rope. And it's directed down the views down the river. And then at the easternmost end is the large water feature that is again a cone that's cut out of the mound. It has 56 jets and a whole sequence of different water effects, and some of them are big enough to knock you over, but it's programmed so that during the week when the little kids are there, it's only small, and on the weekend when it's more boisterous, some of the fat boy it's called. But it's only allowed to start slowly, because if you got hit, you'd be knocked over. So you can see pants come off very quickly. So this has been incredibly popular. The other thing in the email was, how do you measure success of your projects? For me, the great pleasure is just seeing it being used in unexpected ways, and its popularity, you know, with the public. They get 5,000 people a day out here on the weekends, and it's been totally crazy. And in a way, it's falling apart now after 5 years because of its hugely the intense use it gets. Now this is a bit of a collection. We're back into post-industrial sites, and I've called it glebe, although that's not quite right. Glebe is essentially this bit in here. We were commissioned in 2007 to design the foreshore walk, which is 2.7 kilometres. It starts in Roselle Bay, that's right around here, and skips a couple of bits that were done by others, and then finishes in front of the old Walter Burley Griffin incinerator. In 2010 we completed the last section in front of the high school here that joins back towards the fish markets. And then in the last 3 years we've been working on the old Harold Park Raceway. In the last 2 years on the refurbishment of the playground and the former Balmain Rentals over here. So just very quickly, I was going to go through and show you the Glebe Foreshore project first. So the project was fantastic character. That again, that foreshore is very mixed in character, has a lot of nooks and crannies and different materiality. You can walk along there, and through the concrete, the aggregate and the concrete, you get this incredible sense of the period when it was built. You know, sometimes they used big, when they didn't have any aggregate, they couldn't afford it, they used broken bits of sandstone, and then the aggregate was large bits of river stone, and then over time, as those materials were no longer available, there's smaller basalt and then crushed basalt. So there's this really rich fabric and layering over the site. And one of the things I wanted to do was not to come up with a master plan and a great architectural vision and have some regular thing stomping all the way along there like Darling Harbour or Honeysuckle, but you know, to really respond to what was happening. There's accumulations of sand, there is inflections where the wall changed condition, where it went from vertical to sloped. There's moments where there's heritage, and to try and respond to each of those. At the western end, in 1988, they filled the bay here with all sorts of rubbish and created this sort of strange protrusion into the bay. It again was all about exteriority, covered in dog shit, and really not very appealing. We decided that We wanted to introduce a beach because there's no places for small craft to launch. It's very hard for a kayak or a small boat to launch off deep water. So they like to get their foot out onto the firm ground and get into their kayak. So there was this desire to create a beach which would also be for the dogs, but which you could launch small craft from. And then we also wanted to reinstate a mangrove. And there's two mangroves. Before this, there were two mangroves in 27 kilometres of Sydney foreshore left. And this would have all been once mangroves. This whole bay was filled in the 19th century. So we brought 50 mangroves from Sydney Olympic Park and replanted them. They've now, I think 30 have survived now, so 10 years, and they're probably 2.5 to 3 metres. I mean, the dogs are a problem because they get in there and run around and cause a bit of erosion. But this was when it was first completed. And the idea was to create a series of moments along the foreshore, as I said, that sort of change the way you move and orchestrate the way you move and try and make you aware of some of the things that are found on the site. And at this point here was the former jetty. We weren't allowed to put a new jetty out. Maritime took 2 years to tell us that we couldn't, that they basically don't want anything built over the water. But there was an inflection point, so we created a seating space, brought the path down, a moment of rest along the way. At the anchorage, again, there's a moment here where sand accumulates, white sand that far into the harbour is quite remarkable, and it just accumulates in this little corner in here, so we provided a stair down to that. We provided a break in the wall here where you can get down closer to the water. Here are the two mangroves that were previously there. Then we skirted around the development to the old slipway, and again we worked a series of new walls so that you could get access down to the old slipway and also not interfere with the vegetation or the archaeology. One of the drivers for this project was the fact that there was now, because the city had acquired some land, they could now get continuous access around the foreshore, but the condition of the wall wasn't very good and there was overtopping, so we had to raise everything by 400 millimetres so that it was out of the splash zone. And this was done by introducing a series of precast elements that sit on top of the existing wall that are shaped and that weave their way around some of the existing trees and existing remnant bits of concrete to create a new path that wraps its way around the point. Also revealing old stairs. There is a pontoon now built on this point here. And at the old villa on the end of the headland, Lacoste and Stevenson did the heritage work on this, and it's now a cafe. And we orchestrated a walkway, a circuit up through here. This is now quite, the vegetation's come back with endemic vegetation. There's another stair down there onto the oyster, the rock shelf for the oysters. Then as you head further east, this was done by somebody else. You come to the Glebe Rowers, there's a pontoon around the front, and then into what was Glebe High School, which is now Blackwattle Bay High School. And this was the only section where we replaced the wall. There's an old timber wall along here, a vertical wall. There's also a lot of contamination on all these sites, so the trick was to not let the contamination into the bay and not cart it off. It was very expensive. So a wall was designed along there with the opportunity to have some seating and a break in that wall. The school could use some stairs down to the low tide beach or mud there, some new mangroves along the way as well. And what happened between these two projects was that the first project really much relied on concrete and asphalt and sandstone and very much an industrial palette. But the Lord Mayor, somebody got into the Lord Mayor's ear and told them that asphalt wasn't good, so asphalt's been banned now in all City of Sydney projects. And this side then had to use sandstone and crushed gravel, which is a slightly different aesthetic. You'll see that it doesn't have that industrial feel, it's a bit more refined. The large stairs that run into the water, this is where we planted some mangroves, it's just high tide at the moment. And you'll notice this wall, the new wall, let me get the next one, the terraces leading down with the salt marshes. We also, in the first stage, were really conscious of where salt marsh was starting to recolonise. Salt marsh and mangroves grow in a very limited water range, so Salt marshes grow in 100 millimetres of the top of the tide, and mangroves grow in 600 millimetres. So there were spots where the walls were being overtopped and the mangroves were recolonising, and we encouraged that. We created spots where those conditions would be correct for making those habitats. And all of this stuff is lost all over the harbour. Vertical seawalls are disastrous for habitat. Marine habitat needs those perched rock pools and flat areas. And we created in this precast wall a series of nooks and crannies for the water to get trapped and for shells to populate. Then moving on to Harold Park. Harold Park was a raceway that was closed in probably 15 years ago. The site was then sold by the state government. This is the old tram sheds at the top. It's a paceway here. There's a cliff that runs right along this edge here that was excavated to make way for the paceway. And Clastons were engaged to do the master plan for the whole of the foreshore. And you'll see in the next drawing that you can recognise the crescent, the street through here. You can see that is it there now. And so when the state government sold the site to Mervac, this is now all 10 to probably 20 storey apartment buildings. And the park that's left to the City of Sydney is this slither that's quite long. There's another apartment building there that has a very small entry here and then terminates in, again, the Mervac tram shed, which is being converted into commercial use. The residents up the top here in Hoxton Estate didn't want the stairs that were shown in the master plan to give you any access down. They were worried that people would park in their streets and then, you know, go and live here but use their streets. So they managed to convince the city that they should remove all the stairs. So essentially there's one entry here. There's a little funny entry around the back here. Or you go through Mervac's supermarket, and the idea is to buy a coffee to go to the light rail. And then there's the one bridge there. It's a fantastic site, this incredible cliff, and again this insertion of concrete and brick patching the cliff as you go. You can see the quality of the cliff wrapping around, but the scale now of these buildings as they're coming up. So it's a very long, thin site. It also carries overland flow and the floodway, which is this swale here that runs along in front of Mervac, and that was essentially so that these guys could have a deep basement and not flood their basements. Just quickly, a bit of context, the cliff and the sandstone, you can see this would have been the bay previously. It would have come around here and then been out here somewhere, but this was excavated to make way for the tram shed and the paceway, but then the cliff ran around here and that would have all been bay, so that's all the fill. Existing open space, that was the foreshore I just spoke about, and then Harold Park sits back up in the valley here. And the connectivity, there's a light rail station here, there's really connectivity up in this corner and then across the bridge there and that point there, unless you want to go through the supermarket. In terms of the character, just these sorts of accidents here with the weep holes and the ferns growing out of the collision of the sandstone and the brick are fantastic parts of that, the quality of that place at the moment and the scale. So one of the first challenges was to get that scale and the voicing right. And it seemed that part of it was also about tying it back into the surrounding suburb, even though we weren't allowed to have a series of stairs as was proposed in the master plan. It seemed that we'd have to make some strong gestures that were clearly civic to say, yes, you can come in here, yes, this is the way out to reconnect with the suburb, not come and buy something at Aldi on your way to the supermarket or to the train station. So we tried to get some these bridges, because there's a 7 metre level change from the inside the park up to on the street. And so we tried to get these bridges as keys, and there's a series of bridges right around the foreshore that cross the viaduct, there's the viaduct, the aqueduct, there's the viaduct itself. And so the language of bridges seemed to make sense in Glebe. So we fought for that, and we also decided that in terms of a diagram of the plan, there's a large basin at the western end that needed to be crossed. There'd be the potential for a strong connection up to the laneway into those higher streets. A bridge leading you back up to the street here that clearly indicates that you don't need to go through the tram shed. And then the swale that was provided for the flooding should become an abstract vegetation, a band of vegetation hard up against the apartments to give you a bit of scale and a bit of space. We're very much about introducing elements that could deal with the scale of the space, the cliff, these huge apartments, and also the tram shed, rather than just being a landscape with little bitsy things within it. A series of drawings that starting to explore how those bridges might work, how you might make those level changes over towards the next to the tram shed, the bridge, and the potential for a garden underneath that that you also occupy but you look down on your way through. This was the plan which showed that we developed there was a 19th century tram shed garden here with a little memorial and a digger, little white digger on a column and roses, and we thought it would be nice to play with that idea and make this more ornamental down this end, to have habitat under the cliff where we need rain gardens to catch the water off the cliff, have a large informal green, and then have our storm swale here as a strong band of vegetation, which is a sort of the hedge between the private and the public. And then the circulation also hugs that edge so that you have all that sense of space leading away from the apartments. I should say that was killed by some of the architects on the review panel and by Mervac, who really insisted that everybody should come through here, buy their coffee, go up the escalator and pop out the back. I mean, it's just appalling. So we rethought that plan and started to think about, okay, well, we need to get an access around here that's not so obvious. How do we draw the park into this to squeeze past these very expensive apartment blocks, the back end of the tram shed with its access ramp, and then take you to the light rail station? How could we reanimate that wall and introduce the wall to become more part of the garden? The garden here is a distorted 19th. It's a pattern from a 19th century pressed metal ceilings that were found in Glebe, and so we've used that as a motive to generate the garden and distorted it to create a series of grass spaces. This steps up 4 metres from here to here, so that's sort of a series of terraces and slopes which will have an ornamental garden in it. There's a cafe going to be down here, and that was also the sort of separation between the truly public and the commercial. Our resultant scheme is now that rather than going directly from here across here, you'll have to loop back in, come around the wall and up here and then back around, or come around this way. We tried to argue hard that we wanted to avoid people coming from there and doing the cut straight across here, so we had to then reduce the size through here and come back that way. Drawing that, as I mentioned, that fantastic cliff, and the idea was, how can you use this materiality? How can you make use of that and start to let that inform what we might do? And I love the idea that this intriguing shape of brick, sort of, you know, you could never design that sort of weird shape of brick, how you might use that and the floaters, so that maybe that brick could just fall over and land in the park as a platform. We need a couple of platforms for events, for barbecues, and that maybe the floaters could be floaters on legs that provide the shade. So working with Tim Greer again, work a lot with Tim Greer, he developed the idea of the floaters on legs, and we developed these pads that allow you to get up into the playground, that have the picnic facilities, and into that area with the rain gardens. That whole area had to be raised because, again, there's contamination and all the rain gardens had to be raised, so we have a 500 millimetre level change along that edge where the habitat and the rain garden will be. And to do that, we're creating a precast wall, again using concrete precast wall, and then these insertions, these sort of carpets that invite you up into the garden. And I was very interested in the idea of stacks, sort of stacks of bricks, stacks of timber, again a fairly dumb approach to the way the material's put together. So we are making these things, these platforms out of stacks. Gets a lot more complicated because you can't because of the way it's stacked, you can't cut the brick, so you have to make the shapes staggered, so they become staggered stacks. And then TZG have come up with this pairing of floaters, if you like, on legs, and they are clad in Corian. Internally, they have a membrane roof with a perforated aluminium mesh over the top in the same pattern as the garden, so that you get a shadow being cast through the onto the inside of the tent, if you like. So when you're inside, it's like a tent with the shadow coming from the mesh above. We worked with an artist called John Tarry as well and developed a series of elements for the playground. The speaking cones was one of the things that he wanted to. He's making large cones. It was fantastic loudspeakers, being a paceway, all over the place. There's these battered old, megaphone type loudspeakers everywhere. So we've picked up on that. We wanted to make a climbing structure again that was a sort of cubby house, and picking up on the idea of the stack of timber, to make very simply this strange stack of timber with a couple of slides coming out of it that you could climb up through. And then, having grown up in Belgium, the Quisenaire system comes from Belgium. I don't know if anybody else had that, to learn maths, but all those fantastic little coloured blocks. So we've used the Quisenaire system on the back of the climbing stack with some maths. So two whites equals a red, or a white and a red equals a green, and so on. The other thing that happened whilst we were designing this, because of the way the city commissioned this, we were designing before the site was finished, and the geotech and Mervac needed to stabilise the cliff, and what we got was the pudding, I call it. We've got the shotcrete all over the cliff. It's sort of shocking, but in a way it's a bit like what's always happened. The brick infills have now just been replaced with shotcrete. It's a kind of weird, very weird at the moment. And we just said, no, we don't want to dress it up. You're going to do that? You can wear it, Mervac. So we've now got this third texture. We've got the fantastic brick and the sandstone, and now the shotcrete concrete. So we're actually going to make little puddings in the playground. We're going to collect some of the boulders that are left over and make mounds and then shotcrete them. So we'll have mini puddings within the playground, just to remind everybody. So this was also trying to, at one point it looked like the pudding was going to be much bigger and extended. So these were some drawings just trying to think about what you might do with the pudding. Around the southern end of the park, the cliff comes, the pudding comes right out, and it's a pinch point, and we need to get back up to the laneway up here, and the sort of pudding wraps around, and trying to think about how you might get up the remnant of the sandstone excavation with the pudding and that sequence. So a series of drawings just thinking about how that might happen. There you have the pudding. At one point we looked about bridging across from the pudding across to the mid-level and the laneway, but in the end we're going to cut through the cliff and have this stair that goes up the cliff. I'm sorry, it's probably not worth talking about. The line work's not so good, but I just thought that shows more clearly the design of the drawing. And this is all brickwork, so it's quite intricate detailing of jointing and concentric brick patterns. We had Jana from Czechoslovakia spending about 6 months figuring out how the brick detailing should work on all of this, and the timber stack as well. Timber stack's a bit of a challenge, as I mentioned, because we'll have the guy with his Masonic kit come round with his dongles on strings and look for problems on this when it's built. This project is in Parramatta, and we've been engaged in Parramatta now for several years. We were first asked to look at Centenary Square. I don't know if any of you know Parramatta. The railway station is here, the river's here, Church Street runs through here, and that was Church Street Mall. And it used to be it was done in the 80s. It had an amphitheatre, it had a playground, it had a remnant tree, it had a raised planters, had some sculpture. It was just this terrible place full of all sorts of stuff. And our brief was really very simple. It was just to declutter it and make a space that's flexible and starts to project what Parramatta could become by using quality materials. Since we won the open tender with a team, so it was JMD on this one, but the red there is the new Parramatta Square, the $2.2 billion project that involves 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 new buildings, and a square that's 250 metres long and 40 metres wide, which is sort of comparable to Martin Place. And this has the highest building in the Southern Hemisphere on that corner. But we won the tender for the public space about a year ago with a team with TCL, was Taylor Cullity Lethlean, landscape architects from Melbourne, Tompkins Leica Greer, and then Gell, who are the sort of public space, their peer review for us. But firstly, Centenary Square, that it's a beautiful old church, the town hall, and as I said, that it's really a case of tidying up that space, and there's an old monument in there, removing the sense of the mall, introducing a space that could be used for markets and that was flexible. We used their standard pavement, which is an Austral black granite, but we introduced a couple of doormats, or a couple of carpets, if you like, one to denote the square itself and the water feature, and the other directly in front of the town hall. And this pattern was developed just using two different textures in the stone, and it's the same stone, it's incredibly effective how that pattern reads in the light. There's a fountain adjacent to the old clock and drinking fountain that can be turned off so that the place can be used for events. It's a series of movable furniture we designed that were colourful. We wanted the base to be very simple and acidic, and then an overlay. And the city's been very good also at having growers markets, having events, and bringing furniture. They bring chairs and tables out every day so that people can move stuff around, and bean bags. You can see, and the umbrellas can be taken away as well. And the other thing we did was open up, there used to be a garden bed in front of the church, and open up the lawn of the church to create a semi-permeable edge with these concrete seats or walls that still allows you through. And it's really expanded the sense of the space, and it's one of the few green spaces in central Parramatta, and it's got a very nice character, some beautiful old trees, so there's a sense of the garden and the square now sort of interacting a bit. The town hall with its doormat in front of it. Fortunately, heritage colours, I don't know, that sort of pukey pink and yellow, it's just, it's not great. Anyway, there's more of it over here. You can see here the bean bags and they bring out chest sets and bean bags and these colourful little tables and chairs that people can move around, and they get packed away every day. And then we started working on Parramatta Square itself, and I'm just going to show you very quickly. We went through, there's the team, a whole lot of different ideas about how you might organise it. We prepared five concepts for councillors to give some feedback on. It was a huge amount of work, lots of public consultation, lots of different stakeholders. These are just some sketches working through some different ways of considering the space and making that sense of interiority, how you deal with the length and the terminus on the end. The architectural team that had provided the initial master plan, if you like, saw it very much as dead flat, paved, trees, axial, church on the end. Everybody in Parramatta said, we're multicultural, there's lots of different people here, we don't want to have to go into a cafe to enjoy the space, we want shade, it's 10 degrees hotter than Sydney, we want grass, we want green, there's nowhere like that in Parramatta. So we tried to accommodate that in our design. We went through various iterations for what this thing should be, and arrived at this diagram, which essentially is, we called the gathering stream, and the idea was that we had a body of water that went the full 250 metres. In a way it's a bit of a metaphor for the river, it zigzags along to capture entries to buildings, the sunny spot of the site where you could have the grass, the new library up here, the sort of performance space out the front of the library, the entrance to the train station. So it was in a way a device that followed some of the necessity of the space, but also introduced a lyrical quality. And we saw that as being incredibly iconic for Parramatta, this huge water feature that runs the full length, of 250 metres towards the church, and ends in significant artworks, and there'd be a fountain at one end. And the other, it could be turned off quite flexible, it could be turned off for markets at the other end. So the final plan looked something like this, where you have the station with 5,000 people coming out in peak hour, going off in the different directions. So accommodating all of that, accommodating fire engines, accommodating semi-trailers for events, accommodating, this is all on slab, car parks below. New university building with external space and seating for external learning and informal learning. The entries off the building were as yet unspecified, so the finer grain that the community asked for in terms of gardens and smaller spaces were accommodated in these fan shapes. That's all changeable. The sunniest part of the site, because of large developments coming to Parramatta, a lot of overshadowing down this end, and then the relationship between the church, and that's sort of opening out here to Centenary Square as well. See the view there along to the church in the west, and a little detail axonometric showing how it might work. The section, the square is 40 metres. We've now had 9 metre encroachment here, 6 metre encroachment there, 6 metre encroachment here since the architectural competitions are in, and we're redesigning. So this scheme's now kaput, and we're about to start again. Now I've got one last one. I don't know how you're going. I can keep going, but this is Western Sydney. This is Prospect Reservoir, the Great Western Highway, and the M7. Blacktown up here. This is called Bungarabi Parklands. It's Western Sydney Parklands Trust. I don't know if you're aware. The state government set up a trust to manage something like 3,500 hectares of land that wraps around Western Sydney. It sort of follows the M7. And we've been tasked with master planning and designing this section here, which is 340 hectares, which is bigger than Centennial Park in Sydney. So it's a massive new park. It has the M7 running through it. It's the Great Western Highway here, some new residential up here. There are two creeks run through it and sports fields on the northern side. There was a World War II emergency landing strip in here. So that's a kilometre from here to here is a kilometre. And you can just make out here, there's a little cross here, which is the model aeroplane flyers landing strips. And I love that because it tells you where the prevailing wind is. And right next door was the Rocket Launching Club headquarters. Very mysterious people, very secretive. You're not allowed there because they're launching these rockets that go way up, and there's a whole lot of rockets and parachutes stuck in the tree there. When they come down, they get stuck in the trees. Anyway, they've been asked to move. It's too dangerous, apparently, to let the public near them. So, again, we had to, it was an open EOI, so we had to make a response how we'd approach it, and this was a very early response. I mean, Western Sydney is losing its landscape to that sprawl of housing. And on this site, there's a fantastic grassland, and you actually see the sky up against this hill of grassland. And that was one of the things that really caught us, was the quality of the existing site. We don't want to go ruining this. We're losing this at a rate of knots in Western Sydney. How can you insert a park and keep that sense of the open sky? So working kind of strategically, there were three key things we wanted to introduce. Within the site, there was also that grassland as part of a wetland. And so that was the heart. We wanted to keep the heart of the site and not interfere with that, keep that wetland and grassland. The runway was a really strong element, and scaling in that landscape when you've got huge industrial sheds all around it, a freeway up on an embankment, you know, freeway signage, how do you again insert something in the landscape that just doesn't feel totally twee and actually responds to that scale? And the runway gave the clue. But instead of having the runway as a void, actually making it a forest of red gums. So there'd be this block that's nearly a kilometre long, 6,000 trees in a block in the landscape. And then providing circulation around and through the park. This drawing is really about those elements, if you like, that red gum runway, this really strong element from the top of the hill, the heart, the grassland, and then the need through the circulation to cross over the creek in several places. The idea that you would either be in the grassland or you could be in this forest of trunks looking out into the grassland. And how do you organise the forest, the top of the hill, is there something in that runway, that crazy cross, that could become a motive for how you occupy the space so that you don't destroy all the grasslands, but you create these zones that are occupiable? So what we ended up with, also, as we were working on this, Western Sydney Parklands Trust, as part of their deed or whatever it is, they have to be self-funding and they're allowed to lease out 20% of their land. So they've struck a deal with a new zoo that's going to occupy this part here. So what we call the Southern Greenbelt, we have two blocks of trees that we're defining and preserving that heart. One at the runway and the other one here. This one just kept creeping north as the zoo asked for more and more land. So we sort of crashed into our cross and into the existing cross of the model aircraft, but that's where it stopped now. And so that gives us a very strong barrier to what's going to be a commercial zoo with fences and circulation and access roads all the way around it. So we have that Red Gun runway, the Southern Greenbelt, the secondary cross, which will on the top of the hill, which will have all the picnic shelters and the playground that they've asked for, the major playground. The car parks sit within the forests, and then the circulation over to an existing path. It's very noisy here against the freeway, and what came up in working with the British artist was this idea of, he was very much into community. In the UK, they do a lot of community, I guess a bit like men's sheds, and he works a lot with communities to work on crafts that are being lost or traditions that are being lost, and that was what was being suggested up here. So that's been reserved as a zone where you might have a bit more commercial or agricultural type activity. In terms of the park itself, just again, what I mentioned earlier about the drawing becoming more and more important to my work since the PhD is that it's not only drawing about a project, but it's sort of drawing around a project. So I'm painting more and I'm drawing more, and ideas that are in the project sort of appear within the paintings without necessarily being a drawing or a painting about or for the project, sort of letting the drawing go find its own way. So this one is that sort of a drawing, but it does have a sort of distorted cross, the idea of some sort of element that you'll see appears in the project, and then long textural elements of the forest. We needed two crossing points, not three, and some early thoughts about how you might cross the creek. It's quite a steep creek here, whereas out here it's a big floodplain and would need to be much longer. So in the steep part, I had this idea that it'd be nice to have a bridge where you can either take the low road or take the high road. And if you take the high road, you get up above the canopy right in the middle of the creek. And so they cross over. So if you come on your bicycle, you take the low road, you come to the halfway point, and you cross over to the other side, and the stair comes up and crosses over the other way. So there's a sort of a switch in it, and it's supported by these three large truss elements. And again, I like the idea of, like those big billboards on the freeway, working with that language of sort of just fairly simple industrial trusses. I can see it a bit more, and then the idea of it being clad. So we're now looking at it being clad in anodized aluminium. Just timber was getting too heavy. On the southern bridge, there is, as I mentioned, it's a floodway. So the idea that there's a Southern Greenbelt and there's this arc that takes you through the floodway, the potential for it to become a very long bridge somehow didn't seem right. So we came up with the idea, David Warwick and I in the office, that maybe you should hop across this floodway and there'd be a series of raised earth berms. Rather than building a 200 metre long bridge, we create this series of earth berms that then have the bridges between them. So it becomes a sort of an exercise in hopping. And again, these become quite graphic, abstract elements in the landscape that draw you down to cross that creek, because you can't see across the creek, you don't know there's anything to go to. So they're sort of the billboards that could become places you sit as well, provide some shade and give you the crossing across the wet areas. And what those signs, if you like, are clad in is something that was open to speculation. The third built element back up on the hill is the playground, and the playground required again a regional playground with plenty of adventure in it. And the idea of building another sort of, since Blaxland and the Tor Tower, I've kind of become interested in this idea of the structure for playing in, and this one is lying on its side. The idea that it's a sort of strange looking insect, and a bit like one of those aeroplanes they use to practice putting out the fire at the airport. You see them at the side of all the runways. There's those stunted looking aeroplanes that they put on fire and then the firemen go and put out. So the idea that this element would sit and pick up on the geometry of the forest, sit at the top of the hill, and also have a bit of a tower that you could get up to and get fantastic views to the Blue Mountains and distant views, and provide quite a bit of adventure. You get quite high and some long slides off it. And then internally, the thing itself is a bit of a like an ant farm. So you can climb in and you can go between levels, you can drop down between levels, you go up and down, and a series of windows and views out, entry ramps. This was a climbing net that was just too difficult to do structurally. We were then asked to design the entrance to the park before, and this is the first stage of work, before anything else is there, and before the forest is there. And what we wanted to do was pick up again on the language that we're developing for the bridges and the tower, and somehow use that as a marker on this busy road with four-storey, 50, 60 metre long sheds across the road, semi-trailers going the whole time. You know, they had a little sign, Bungarabi Parklands, on a little stone wall. It's just not going to cut it. It really had to be something that was quite large. At the same time, I started to think about, I did a painting workshop with Idris Murphy, the landscape painter. He said to me, you know, I don't know why you're worrying about that. You're not in the landscape tradition. 16th century landscape painting, European tradition landscape painting, it's not really, you've got this whole background of landscape architecture with all these symbols and drafting symbols and conventions. Why don't you explore those? And, which made me think, well, okay, what about all the geological, the bores and the logs for the soil, the map, the models on the, the symbols used in soils and geology. And so that started to come into some of the paintings, and then the idea that maybe that's what we should be using on these billboards, this sort of highly hatched architectural landscape symbolism just wrought large back onto the billboards as a signage. So as we were developing, and that's the main entry, the two forests, the runway and the southern greenbelt, will come and stop at Doonside Road, but when it's built at the end of this year, the trees are going to be this big in little pink tree guards. And again, we don't have that presence. So we thought, well, why don't we bookend our forest and actually start to suggest the volume that this will become by creating these markers in the landscape. And we take the pattern that we've got on the bridge with our trusses and sort of invert it. And this is the corporate pink that they have for their Western Sydney Parklands Trust. But we build that, and where the pedestrian entrance is, we invert it and we use our specific sort of landscape graphic that we've developed. So this is sort of some tests in the land at the back of the office. How far, how big does it need to be? And then this is the first stage, just finished about 3 weeks ago. See that the forest will run off here, so that the tree planting runs off there. The zoo will be on this side. This runway runs right down here. The creek's in the distance there. So that defines that zone of 6,000 trees, red gums and ironbarks that will be through there. The entrance portal with the gates, you come through, and the pedestrian entry under the patterned entry. Thank you.